One thing I want to mention, too, that I started to do this week, any of the messages, and I'll ask who's ever speaking as long as they're okay with it as well. I've been putting them on YouTube. Last week's message, I figured out how to convert over to YouTube so I could actually share it, and I'm going to link it to the church's website as well so that the messages will actually be on the website. So like Manny or whoever can go on and click and link it, but it is last week's messages on YouTube. I'll do this week as well. It's not an easy task to do because there is some converting, but I did figure out how to do it. And anybody else who's speaking, so if Pastor Sharon or Pastor Gary or Pastor Charlene or Pastor Alice is speaking, I'll ask as long as they're comfortable with me doing that, we'll do that with their messages as well. But it's just the way other people can hear it. So, you know, last week I did a lot of talk about what seems right, you know, and God is amazing, as we all know. You know, guys, we're not a problem-driven people. We're a promise-driven people. We're a promise-driven people. Thank you, Jaden. Promise-driven. And every promise is what? Yes and amen in God. Every one of His promises, everything He has promised to us is yes and amen. When I emailed my mother, Pastor Charlene, this week, and you know, she had asked me what the title would be, and I just put part two, because last week's title was Truth That Sets You Free and Grace That Empowers You to Become Love. And again, a lot of what I talked about, a lot last week. I talked about the way we think about things, the way we react to things because of the fall of man, and how when something goes wrong in our lives, you know, we go to react to it, and we got to step back and say, would that come out of Jesus' mouth? Because if it wouldn't come out of Jesus' mouth, then it shouldn't come out of mine. If it wouldn't come out of Jesus' heart, then it shouldn't come out of mine. And the only way to do that is to renew your minds. There's no other way to do it but to renew your minds into what Jesus did. As I said, Jesus was the visible image of the invisible God. He was God in the flesh. He was what God looks like to man. And God said, be imitators of Him. Be imitators of Him. Think about that. God, the creator of everything, is saying, imitate me. Imitate me. That's amazing. That's amazing. Because God says, imitate me. Do as Jesus did. Walk in love. Because it's all about love. The miracles are great. I love them. Okay? But they're not everything. Love is everything. Miracles are just a byproduct of who we are, who we were created to be. Miracles are just to show the world out there the reality of this gospel. You know, I said last week that after the service, we were all going to the mall. Swell and I are leaving in a couple weeks to go to Florida, and we wanted to go do some shopping down at the mall. And while we were walking around the mall, I ended up, I think it was the store, PS store, it's a kid's store, so we bought stuff for the kids too, but I ended up leaning on the customer service desk in the middle of the Rockaway Mall, and Jaden was standing with me, and Suwan was in shopping, and I was just standing there, and the security guard came up, and he was full uniform, and probably in his middle 20s, 22 to 25 years old, and he walked by me, and I said, hey, man, what time does the mall close? He goes, oh, 6 o'clock. I said, all right, I appreciate it. And he kind of looked at me strange. I said to him, hey, do you do anything else besides work here? He goes, oh, yeah. He goes, I'm really into jujitsu. He goes, I travel the East Coast in competitions all over. He goes, I love it. He goes, I really, really enjoy it. He goes, the martial arts is my life. And he lifts up his hand, and he shows me his hand. He goes, I got to show you. Now, here's a kid working in a mall, working, and his thumb is dangling. And it's completely swollen to here. And I said, what did you do? And he said, yesterday he was in a competition. And when he went down on his hands to kick back, his thumb dislocated. I said, why are you here? He goes, I said, that's got to be painful. And he goes, yeah, it's really painful. He goes, I couldn't get anybody to cover for me. And he goes, if I didn't show up today, I'd probably lose my job. So tomorrow I'm going to go to the doctor's. And I'm looking at him, and Jaden's standing with me. I said, you got to do me a favor. He goes, what's that? I said, on the counter here, we're right at the customer service desk. I said, just put your hand right there. And he goes, okay. And I said, I'm not going to touch your hand because I can tell it hurts. I said, put your hand there. So he puts his hand on the counter, and I put my hand over the top of his hand by about 3 inches, and I started commanding his thumb to pop back into joint and the swelling to go down. And as I started to pray, I saw his eyes get big. And I said, what are you feeling? And he said, I feel it moving in there. He goes, it's really, while my hand's sitting there, while you're praying, I feel it moving in there. I said, that's God. He lives inside of me and is amazing. So I said, check it. And he goes, you know, it feels better. It still hurts a little. And he goes, wow, I think the swelling's going down a little bit. I said, well, put it down again. I prayed again. And then I prayed the second time. That bone popped right back into place. It was amazing. When I left there, he took my hand. Now, here's a kid who had his thumb dangling in pain. Took my hand and he grabs it like this with that hand and shakes my hand firmly. So I knew he wasn't in pain anymore. He said he wasn't. And 99% of the swelling was gone when I left. And then he starts telling me the reality of he believes. He's a believer. He was going to Faith Christian Church in Jersey. And he says, I was going a long time, but, you know, it just got to be where, you know, life. He goes, you know how life can be. And he goes, you know, I was going and just something there. I got consumed with other things. He goes, I got to go back. And I said, you're right, you do. I said, but you know something? Why did you leave? Well, I'm not sure. I said, because you were going to church to find something when the reality is you already have it. We don't go to church to find love. We go to church to be love. We don't go find love. That's why people leave churches. Lots of times they go and they say, well, I don't like the way this one treated me, or I don't like the way that one treated me. So they go find a different church because they got to go be loved instead of go and be love. And that's what we are. And I started talking to him about the reality of who he is and his identity. And the fact that Christ made him brand new. What I just did there, and I told him that my son, Jaden, I've seen him pray for people. 10 years old, sorry. I did say 9 and you corrected me. 10 years old, okay, have prayed for people and seen them healed. Why? Because he doesn't have a junior Holy Spirit. He's got the same as you and I. And the kid's like, wow, this is amazing. And we talked, he goes, how do I get a hold of you? So I gave him one of the ministry cards. I said, you can call me anytime. He goes, really, anytime? I said, you have a question about anything. I don't care if it's 1 a.m. My phone rings all night for my job. I said, call me. Okay. This life is amazing. This life is amazing. You know, I have 5 children. 4 of which are here. This life can be crazy at times. 5, yes. Kaya's my other child. We've adopted her. You run and run and run and run and run. I run to work. I run to sporting events. I run to plays. And you run. And you say, okay, God, when do I have time for you? All day. While I'm at a sporting event. While I'm at a play. Because he's inside of me. He's made me new. I want to look at a couple different verses today. Flip to my page here. You know, last week I talked a lot about the fall of man and what happened. Let me get this to stay open. If you would, can we look at Genesis 3 real quick? Here, I'm going to open up to it. While you're looking, I want to tell you something. The devil, guys, do you know the devil is forever condemned? Do you know the devil never has a chance again? He's eternally condemned forever. The devil tried to overthrow God. The devil tried one time. And what happened? He was defeated. He was sent out. He was cast out of heaven. And 1 out of 3 angels was sent with him. See, the devil knows he can't overthrow God. What the devil isn't sure of is whether he can overthrow our minds in the reality of who God created us to be. See, the church has lost her identity. The church has lost the fact of Paul and Peter walking around and miracles just happening everywhere and thousands coming to know him on the streets. We've made it into, let's get him to our building so I can preach them a message and hope they'll understand. It's about out there. It's about walking around in love. It's about being so different that when you just walk, people say, whoa, there's something really different about them. They walk differently. We're a peculiar people. Thank you. I'm going to read a little bit here. Genesis 3, the fall of man. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animals the Lord had made. He said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from the tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. Now let me ask you a question. We know shortly later they ate. Did they die? Did they fall over and die? They didn't die. Was God lying? They didn't die. They didn't die. You know what happened, guys? What they were created for died. Their image. God said when he picked up the dust and he blew in it, he said, I've made man in my image. So the image that God created them to be died when they ate from that tree. The devil said, you will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took it and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool day, and they hid from the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to them, where are you? He answered, I heard you in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. And he said, who told you you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I've commanded you not to eat from? The man said, the woman you put here, me here, she gave me for the fruit. Boy, it's just like us men, right? They blame everybody else. Okay? It says Adam was right there with her when she took it. Okay? Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you've done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate it. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your lives. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. To the woman he said, I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. With pain you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband. He will rule over you. To Adam he said, because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree about to which I commanded you, you must not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Cursed is the ground because of you. So literally the ground, the earth was cursed. It was cursed. I'm going to stop there in Genesis. And I want to flip over to, and I keep losing my page up here, but I want to flip over to Romans 8:18. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that was revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation patience for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration. The creation was cursed in the beginning. It was subjected to frustration. Not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, Adam. In hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning. The ground has been literally groaning. It was cursed. Everything's alive. It's been cursed because of what Adam did. And it's been groaning. For what? As in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who are the first fruit of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoptions as sons, the redemptions of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen and no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? Do you realize that when we bring heaven to earth, when we manifest God's presence through us, the ground underneath of us has been groaning, waiting for that to happen. The ground underneath of us has been groaning, waiting for the sons of God to be revealed, for God to be manifest on earth through us, bringing heaven to earth, flowing through us, touching somebody that's lost out there. He said, and I said it last week, he's given us dominion everywhere we walk, everywhere we go. And the ground underneath of us has been groaning because it was cursed through Adam. But because of Christ being alive in us, Christ is alive in us. We're dead. Christ is alive in us. And because he is, the ground is groaning. But now when I manifest God, guess what? The ground then becomes holy because I am. Everywhere I walk, everywhere I go. It's eagerly waiting for us to manifest God. The earth is. It's eagerly waiting. See, God did everything. God could do whatever he wants. God could say, guess what? It's all back alive. It's all back to where it was. No, what he did is he said, I'm going to make you responsible, and you responsible, and you responsible, and you responsible to bring the ground alive again underneath your feet. It's time we as a body represent this gospel. It's time we represent Jesus to the world. People are done with the church, guys. I hear it on the streets. They've seen it. They've seen it all. They've heard it all. Oh, I don't want any of that, John. I went there and I just, they're a bunch of hypocrites. They say this and then they do this. What if we live it? We don't just say it, but we live it everywhere we go. And they say, wow, I've never seen that before. That's new. I'm telling you, I hear it day in, day out from people I talk to that once went to church and walked away, or some that have never went and said, I don't want any of that because I'm happier than they are. Jesus paid a price so that we don't look here, but we reign from here to here. We reign from heaven to earth. We keep our mind set on things above, never allowing anything, any circumstance, any problem to blow us, wind, waver us at all. But to keep our eyes single on what he did for us and how he created us in his image, in his likeness, full of his glory, which is Christ in us, the hope of glory. You know, the other night I was sitting in bed and God's amazing. I'm telling you, the time with God alone, there's just things that happen that I can't describe. And all of a sudden I heard my email go off and I opened it up. And it was another prayer chain request on someone who's a believer who's being attacked by the enemy who was defeated. Because all sickness and all disease comes from the enemy. Okay? Circumstances and problems that happen in our lives are different than sickness and disease. Trials are different than sickness and disease. Because sickness and disease all come from the enemy. It all comes from him. And we need to point that out. So I'm reading this email and I started bawling. I said, God, your son paid a price. He hung on a cross. He was beat and whipped for this sickness. And I'm tired of seeing your church get hurt. I'm tired of seeing the enemy poke your church. And he said to me, then you need to do something about it. Because it's your responsibility, son. It's your responsibility to go after it and destroy it and to step on the enemy's neck and put him back into the place he belongs. The trials and circumstances we go through, whether it be the accident that I was in a couple weeks ago, a week and a half ago, those things are going to happen in life, okay? But they're supposed to potter us closer to our Father. Potter us closer to him. It's okay. That's okay, son. Things happen. Our circumstances are supposed to be so we can, other people around us can see God's glory. So that when I'm going through a problem at work and everybody around me knows it, and at the end of it, I'm just with a big smile on my face, thanking my Father still. And they're saying, how is he able to do that? Because I'm dead and Christ is alive. And that's when they say, I want this. But I can tell you, sickness and disease is something we need to go after and get rid of. It's pure from hell. And it needs to be destroyed. And he's given us the ability to do that. So as I was crying out to God, and I was because I got angry, not at God, but at the devil, because I'm seeing another brother, another sister be poked by the enemy and touched with some kind of sickness, some kind of disease, and it needs to end. He paid a price for every bit of it, but we need to see clearly to go after it. We've got to see what he did. We've got to have his word so in us that when we go, there's no wavering. There's no being blown side to side. But we go and we say, you know something, sickness? Get out. You don't have a right. You know, the other day, this was 2 days ago, Friday night. It's pouring rain. The grass was slippery in my yard. And I got out of my car and I shut the car and one of the kids were arguing in the back and I turned around because of it. And when I did, the grass was very slippery. I went just like this and I felt a pop in my lower back. I did. And I walked right inside and said to Sue Ellen, uh-oh, I just hurt my back. And she says, what'd you do? So I tell her what I did. She's like, well, you better take it easy. I said, I'm gonna. I went to bed, my back was hurting. And I said, God, it has no right to hurt me. I'm your son. It has no right. When I wake up tomorrow morning, and I said this to my wife, when I wake up tomorrow morning, it's going to be gone because I believe. And I woke up and it was gone. There was no pain in my back. Why? Because I refuse to see any differently. I refuse to let anything, even the pain I was experiencing, let me see differently. The church has failed to represent this amazingly true gospel. We have spent decades preaching it's all about getting to heaven. The church was blinded by great deception and hypocrisy, condemning one another and forgetting the simplicity of the gospel, which is all about love. The gospel is not about getting to heaven, but our identity being restored to Christ-likeness. It's about heaven getting into us so we can manifest Jesus to the world. If I'm dead, then he's the only one that's alive. See, we keep... You know, I spoke about this a few months ago. When John the Baptist said in the beginning, he said, you know something? He said, less of me and more of you. And we've made songs about that. We've made songs about singing less of me and more of him. And as I said a few months ago, when I was praying and singing, I was actually praying that, I heard in my heart, how can there be less of you if you're dead? And I said, whoa. And I started reading why John said what he said. It was never about being less of me and more of him. It was about the fact that he, John, was closing out an old covenant. So he had to back out of the picture so Jesus could step in and establish the kingdom of God on earth. Jesus never said, less of me, more of you. He never said to say that. But we've made doctrines out of it. I've sung it. Oh, Holy Spirit, less of me and more of you. And I'm telling you, the number one thing I heard in my heart is, how can there be less of you when I killed you, when you were crucified with me? How could there be less of you when you were crucified with me and raised up, and now you're seated with me in heavenly places? We need to change this. I'm telling you, it's all about here and how we view things and how we look at things. You know, I said it last week, Jesus came for what? For that which was lost. What was lost? Our identity. Our identity was lost in the fall of man. He came and restored that. We were redeemed. Redemption means brought back. Brought back. We were justified just as if we never sinned. There's so many of us that remain sin conscious. He destroyed sin consciousness. We're dead to it. And I need to repeat this because it's so powerful. It is. That if I do something wrong, you're not to remain there ever. Ever. So if I screw up and I make a mistake, instead of me staying there for 5 days, woe is me, oh, I'm no good, God, forgive me, I'm horrible, forgive me, I'm wretched. It's, Father, I so thank you that you showed me that was wrong. I so thank you that because of the light you put on my life and inside of me, I now see that that action is wrong. Because if you didn't show me, God, I'd have done it anyway. But because there's something new inside of me, I now know this is wrong. And I'm going to walk towards you and walk away from that. And you spend 1 or 2 seconds there, and you walk away, and you never think about it again. Because the number one thing the enemy wants to do, a week later, 2 weeks later, 5 years later, you're driving in your car, and all of a sudden you hear, hey, do you remember when? Oh, how could I have done that? Oh, God, why did I do that? That was really stupid of me back then. Oh, God, I'm so sorry, God. And God's saying, wait a minute, son. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? That's the reality. It's amazing. There's nothing less than being excited and walking around with a smile on your face. Because it's amazing. Doesn't mean I'm not accountable for my actions. It means that his light showed me what was wrong, so I repented. Repenting isn't confessing. Repenting is changing my mind, changing the direction I was going, and walking towards my Father. And Jesus did all that. Do you know Jesus never said to sing to him? Jesus never said to worship him? I'm all for it. I do it all day. Jesus said to follow him. Jesus said, here's my sandals, son. Here's my sandals. If you put them on and you walk in your new man and you realize that you're dead, your old nature is completely gone, and you put on my sandals, John 14:12 says, I can do everything he did and greater. But we got to be willing to take off ours. We've got to be willing to take off the old man, the old way we think, the old way we act, and put on his. We've got to be willing to do that. You know, the commandments Jesus gave us was what? Love God with everything you are, and love one another as you love yourself. The only way you can love yourself is when you look in a mirror, you see nothing less than Christ. That's the only way. You can even love your neighbor easier than you can love yourself. Because if you're looking in that mirror and you're not seeing with an unveiled face Christ staring back at you, you can't love. You have to love yourself. And then it doesn't matter when your neighbor, you get a phone call from a friend who says, hey, I want to let you know that your neighbor was just saying this and this and this about you. And they were saying this and this. And your so-called friend is just pouring it in, what everybody's saying about you. See, what happens when you know who you are, you don't hurt because of them. You hurt for them because they can't see what you see. You don't cry because, oh, how could they say that about me? You cry because, God, please, whatever it takes, God, whatever I must do, they've got to see this. They've got to see this because when they see this, their actions will change. But they've got to see God. It's all about what they need to see because I see clearly, God. I see clearly. I wasn't created for them. I was created for you. Do you know how amazing that is? Do you know how amazing it is when you're standing in a mall and I see people? I observe a lot when I'm praying for people. And people are like, or I walk over and we're looking with Brandon's girlfriend. We're walking over and we're looking at cell phone cases. And I ask the girl who's selling them, by chance, you have any pain anywhere? She looks at me kind of funny. She says, no, I don't. I said, all right. I said, hey, can I just say a quick prayer for you? And the two girls that work there are looking at me like, I'm insane. And I just bless them, and I pray for them. And you know something? I'm not saying anything happened. But you know something? It doesn't matter. Because I was willing. All I did was say, hey, Father, I ask that you financially bless both of these two young women. I ask, God, that you show them who you are and how amazing they are in you. And then I thanked them, and they had this smirk like, this guy's crazy. But you walk away. And 5 minutes later, you pray for a guy's thumb that pops back into place. Now, I could have let that affect me and walked away. So, oh, I that affected me and missed the opportunity of praying for somebody and watching his thumb pop back in place. But I see clearly. I see clearly that they're not my potter. I see clearly that my Father's the only thing I need to go after. The other thing, we cannot let sin against us produce sin in us. When somebody does something to hurt me, okay, I can't immediately allow sin to be produced. That's fall of man, old nature. I need to cry out so they can see the reality of who my Father is. I need to cry out so they can see the reality who God is and who Christ is. When you do that and they know it, they don't know how to handle it. Jesus. If we don't see it in Jesus' life, it shouldn't be in ours. He didn't pay a price to get us to heaven. Jesus never said to sing songs and worship him. I'm all about it. Please don't hear me wrong. I love singing to Jesus. I love worshiping Jesus. But most of all, you know what makes Jesus and my Father happy? Is when I represent him to others. The church has made it all about getting together and singing songs and staying here. And I'm not saying God doesn't want that. Revival isn't when all of a sudden there's a spiritual move of God within a church, and there's lines down the road because something's going on and people are coming. Revival is when you and you and you and you and you and you and you all wake up to the reality of who you created to be. Because you're unstoppable. Because it's not you, it's Him. And I want to clarify something. Let's wake up into the world where animals talk for a minute. And all of a sudden, there's a bunch of animals in a barn. They're all in this barn, and they're all talking. All these animals to each other. And in comes this donkey. This donkey's walking into that barn, and he's strutting his stuff. And they're like, man, what's up with him? And the donkey's like, man, let me tell you about my day. Let me tell you about my day. I just had the most amazing day. And they're like, what are you talking about? And he said, hey, I just walked through a town. And guess what? They were all worshiping me. They were laying down branches. And they called me by my name, Hosanna. And they're like, wait a minute. Donkey, who are you carrying? Oh, some guy named Jesus. But it's all about me. We're just a donkey carrying a king. But the king is amazing. The king is amazing. And he wants you to know, so are you. Put him on like a glove and run this race and finish well. It doesn't matter what's happened yesterday. Run this race and finish well. And show everybody what love is. Show everybody, everywhere you are, what love is. You know, I know what it was like to be a teenager in school where you have your cliques and you have your friends and everybody's... Show the world, show the ones that are talking about you what love is. All of you. It'll change you. I promise. We are Christians to fulfill the reason He made us. A Christian to bear witness of His image, His heart, and let my light shine so bright. We all go through things, guys. We all go through trials. We all go through circumstances that look like, to the visible eye, they look like, man, this is a big mountain in front of me. How am I getting over this? But when we change our perspective, see, that's what Jesus came to do. Change your perspective about the circumstance in front of you. Change your perspective about the trial that's there. He came so that as you walk through the fire, you know, the fire was never the issue. As you came and as you walk through the fire, you come out and you never even smell like smoke. But you come out and you're like, everybody around you's like, whoa, who are they? How is this? How could this be? And you say, it's because it's Jesus. He's alive in me. I'm all about miracles. I love them. I really do. But it's not about miracles. It's about love. It's about if you're at your job and someone's hurting, you step out and just put your arm around and tell them you love them. Or if you even pray for somebody. I prayed for somebody this week at my job, and they walked away still in pain. But they know I love them. This is a growing process. My message isn't to bring you to a place of condemnation. My message is to bring you to a place so you can see clearly. And if your body is full of light, there's nothing, there's no darkness. And if you keep your eyes focused on Him at all times, I'm telling you, this life, Jesus came us to give us abundant life. There's so many different doctrines. It's about money. He came to financially abundantly bless us. I don't pray for things. God knows what I need. I pray to know him more. That's my whole prayer every day. My whole prayer every day is, Father, I want to know you more. I want to know you more, Father, so the world can see who you are. There's too many people suffering, Dad. There's too many people that don't know the truth. They don't know what Jesus did for them. They don't know what he went through. Father, if you show me more, if you reveal the mysteries to me, God, if you give me a spirit of wisdom and revelation, God, I promise you, Father, that everywhere I go, I'm going to share it with the world. That's my cry every day. It's not, I need more money. It's not, I need a better job. It's to become more like him. Because that's what we were created for in the first place. To be just like our dad. And Jesus fulfilled it all. We just need to change the way we view everything around us. Everything needs to change. I know a lot of people have been here, have been going through a lot of different things. I mean, Emily just lost her amazing mom, who's now dancing in heaven and have an amazing time. But God wants to fill you so full of him. He wants you to, that when you walk out of here today, on your drive home, you're just talking to him as he's sitting right there, because he is. He's everywhere. Do you know that before I prayed for that kid at the mall, he was already there? He wants you to be so full of him. See, the rivers that we talk about, we say, oh God, rivers of living water flow out of me. They're not for us, those rivers, guys. They flow out of us for everyone else around us. This life is awesome. And there's going to be trials. And there's going to be problems. But I'm not problem-driven. I'm Christ-driven. I love you all so much. And I couldn't do that without knowing how much you love me. I believe this morning that some of you should come up and just let me pray for you. Because he wants to touch some of your lives. I believe this morning that the Holy Spirit wants to fill you with joy and happiness. Wants to fill you with hope. Wants to fill you with love. I'm excited. I wake up every day excited because of what he did for me, because he did it all. And all I need to do is believe it. I don't need to do anything else. Just to believe it. I love you all with all of my heart. God has changed my life where, you know, there were things that happened in my wife and my relationship years ago. And I gotta tell you something, God has changed my life so much that I love him more now than I ever have. And I didn't think that was possible. I didn't think it was possible. Because most of our love's out of sensuality, not reality of Christ. When the reality of Christ hits your heart, when it hits your heart, you run this race and you finish well. I promise. Every one of you. God predestined everyone. before the foundations of the world. He predestined you to run a race well, to finish well, to never look at tomorrow, but to step in His will today.
Today's the day.
Step in and enjoy it, because it's amazing.
Brandon, stop recording. Father, I thank you.